Good morning. My name is Dolores Perez Heilbrunn, and I'm doing a recognition of the Ohlone Nations here. We, the members of the First Unitarian Universalist Society of San Francisco, acknowledge that we live and work in the ancestral lands of the Ramaytush Ohlone peoples, who have served as stewards of this region for generations. Today, we, the members of the First Unitarian Church, further recognize that as the original stewards of this land, the Ohlone understood the interconnectedness of all things and maintained harmony with all of nature for millennia. We honor them for their enduring commitment to our Mother Earth. As the indigenous stewards of this land and in accordance with their traditions, these tribes have never ceded, lost, or forgotten their responsibilities as caretakers of this land. As guests, we recognize that we benefit from living and working in their traditional homelands. Thank you.
And once again, good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here. Thank you, those of you online, on Zoom. There's quite a few actually on Zoom. And more are coming on actually quite quickly. We're very fortunate and very happy to have Medea Benjamin with us today. One could truthfully spend the better part of this forum on her important contributions to the anti-war and other social justice movements and causes. She's the author of various books, among them on one on drone warfare, on Saudi Arabia, very importantly on the Islamic Republic of Iran, and of course this book, War in Ukraine. And there may be others that I don't know about. She's been an activist and a leader in many arenas of struggle. She's the initiator of activist organizations, Global Exchange and Code Pink. And I have one personal experience with the effect of her work, something that has remained with me down through the years, which I think shines a light on the kind of role Medea has played. Those of us old enough to remember the aftermath of 9/11, 2001, we might remember the enormous wave of nationalism, chauvinism, and racism that poured from US politicians and the major media. Directed especially at Arabs, Muslims, and South Asians. And there was even serious discussion in the government of forcing members of those communities to a special registration. And there were violent attacks and many, many verbal attacks on these communities. And in the midst of this wave of hysteria, I recall I was walking in the mission, it was right around that time, and I was very heartened to see in the windows of the stores, many of the stores in the mission district, posters in different languages with a message that stood out very powerfully in contrast to the general atmosphere. And it said something to the effect of, this neighborhood is a no hate zone. And it was put out by Global Exchange, as I recall. And it had a very positive effect, an immediate effect, as it came very quickly after this wave, in the midst of this wave of chauvinism, and stood in contrast to that. And it really did change the social atmosphere in a very important way. And I think it was a good example of how going against the tide of hatred and lies in key moments can be crucial. And I think it's important to keep that in mind in thinking about this forum today and what Medea is doing and others are attempting to do in terms of understanding more deeply this war. I just want to give one more example, more of a historical example, that illustrates, I think, the principle here. When it comes to inter-imperialist rivalry, which is what is going on with this war in Ukraine, it is the responsibility of those who seek to play a progressive role in such moments to, while oppose all imperialists, especially the, it's crucial to especially expose the lies and dangerous maneuvers of one's own government. A very stark example of this was the failure to do this in World War I, when nearly all the progressive and socialist organizations that had pledged to oppose their own governments on the eve of that war, which began in, you might remember, in July of 1914, reneged on that promise and lined up behind their own government's distortions and dishonest justifications once the war began. And this resulted in a horrible catastrophe for the world. Had these organizations, some of which were large and influential in Europe at the time, not capitulated, the outcome of that war would likely have been quite different and much better for humanity. Medea, from my understanding, has time and again risen in a timely way to denounce the lies and crimes of our government, the US, while pointing out the broader historical context in which these conflicts take place. And she's done so again today with her writing and her speaking on the war in Ukraine. So with that, I'll introduce Medea and let her take it away from there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bruce. You can hear me okay?
Yes.
Great. So I'm sorry not to be there in person, although I am coming to the Bay Area and we'll be doing a number of events that you can see online at codepink.org under the Ukraine book tour. This is part of a book tour that I started about a month ago. My colleague Nicolas Davies and I wrote a book called War in Ukraine, Making Sense of a Senseless War. Its pub date was just a couple of days ago, November 15th. But we've been out speaking about this war around the country. And it's been so interesting to talk to different kinds of groups, students groups, church groups, Rotary Club type organizations, people with very different political affiliations. And what I'm starting to see is not only a desire to talk more about this war and how it happened, but people starting to see that this war is affecting the whole world. And therefore the world has to get involved in trying to figure out how to stop it. So we did an 18 minute video to accompany the book that I wanted to show you today because it gives a background and the context for this war. And if there are questions that arise during the video, please jot them down. Then I'll give an update about where things are today and then open it up for a discussion. So thank you very much for giving me the chance to talk to you today, and I'm going to start the video.
Let's talk about the heartbreaking war in Ukraine and what we could do to try to end it. Every day the war rages on, civilians and soldiers are being killed. Millions of Ukrainians have been forced to flee and seek asylum in foreign lands. Schools, hospitals, apartment buildings, and infrastructure have been reduced to rubble. We wrote this book to try to help people make sense of a war that should never have happened, a war that has raged on for months and might well rage on for years, a war that could lead to a nuclear confrontation. A war that must be stopped. We know that people have very different opinions about this conflict, and we hope that our book and this talk will foster respectful dialogue. We have not tried to justify or excuse Russia's invasion of Ukraine because we do not think it is justifiable or excusable. We hope we can help you understand the context, the background, and the actions of all the parties that led to this crisis. As US citizens, we have very little hope of influencing the Russian government but we should be able to influence our own government, which is why it's so important to look at the role the United States has played in fomenting the conflict. Let's look at two elements of U.S. involvement that we highlight in our book, NATO expansion and the events of 2014. Western leaders call NATO a defensive military alliance, but NATO was formed to defend Western Europe from invasion by the Soviet Union. That mission was accomplished when the Soviet Union disintegrated in 1991. NATO should have been dissolved at the end of the Cold War, along with the Warsaw Pact, which was NATO's counterpart in the Eastern Bloc. Instead, NATO reinvented itself to justify its continued existence. It expanded all the way to Russia's borders, despite many promises that it would not do so, and ignoring warnings from experienced US and Western diplomats that this would lead to a predictable yet entirely avoidable crisis with Russia, as in fact it has. You can see the map showing the various waves of expansion in which NATO incorporated former Soviet republics and Russia's European neighbors. In 2018, the antagonism reached new heights when NATO, under US pressure, publicly promised membership to the former Soviet republics of Ukraine and Georgia. While no definite date was set, NATO began supplying increased levels of military aid and training to Ukraine, including Ukraine in military exercises. So Russia certainly had legitimate concerns about Ukraine's involvement in an ever-expanding military alliance that was encircling Russia with powerful military forces and had already unleashed aggressive wars and occupations in Kosovo in 1999, Afghanistan in 2001, and Libya and Syria in 2011. The other event that served to set the stage for the Russian invasion in 2022 was the coup in Ukraine in 2014. The 2014 upheavals began with massive peaceful protests against the corrupt pro-Russian president Viktor Yanukovych. Unfortunately, though, these protests turned violent and were co-opted by neo-Nazi groups that refused to go along with an internationally negotiated plan for a political transition, and instead, they spearheaded a coup. The extent of U.S. support and involvement in this coup is still shrouded in secrecy, as are previous U.S.-backed coups in Iran, Chile, and many other countries. But a leaked audio tape of Assistant Secretary of State Victoria Nuland and U.S. Ambassador Jeffrey Pyatt exposed their roles as coup managers as they handpicked what positions each of their Ukrainian collaborators would assume in the post-coup government. Although the original peaceful protests in Ukraine were about wanting to join the European Union, Nuland dismissed the European Union's more popular choice for prime minister, Vitali Klitschko, with her infamous F the EU remark. According to a Gallup poll conducted in April 2014, nearly 50% of Ukrainians rejected the legitimacy of the post-coup government. This led to rebellions in parts of Ukraine that were ethnically and culturally close to Russia. In Crimea, a peninsula on the Black Sea with a mostly Russian-speaking population that was part of Russia from 1783 until 1954, as well as in the eastern provinces of Luhansk and Donetsk. In Odessa, 42 anti-coup protesters were burned to death by a mob on May 2, 2014. The new government in Ukraine was rejected by the parliament in Crimea, and a referendum to rejoin Russia passed overwhelmingly and was accepted by Russia but not recognized by other countries. The provinces of Luhansk and Donetsk also passed referendums declaring themselves independent from Ukraine leading to a civil war that killed an estimated 14,000 people. Many Ukrainian military units based in this region defected to the self-declared People's Republics or refused to fight their own people. So the Ukrainian government formed new National Guard units to fight the separatists. These included units like the Azov Battalion, recruited from the same neo-Nazi groups that took up arms to spearhead the coup in Kiev in February 2014. The worst fighting of the Civil War ended in February 2015 with the signing of the Minsk II Accord. This was drafted by France, Germany, and Russia, and agreed to by Ukraine and the self-declared republics. It set up a ceasefire and a buffer zone between the warring parties and was monitored by 1,300 monitors and staff from the OSCE, which is the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. While the ceasefire largely held from 2015 to 2022, the Ukrainian government failed to implement the political aspects of the Minsk II agreement. It had agreed to grant Donetsk and Luhansk a new autonomous status, but each time the Ukrainian government tried to move forward on this, extreme right-wing forces re-exerted their power and insisted that Ukraine must instead keep fighting to recover its lost territories. NATO and the US also bear responsibility for the failure of Minsk II. Despite officially claiming to support the agreement, NATO and the US, under both Trump and Biden, kept building up Ukraine's military, encouraging the Ukrainian government to believe it could eventually recover Donbas and Crimea by force, and that the US and NATO would support that. As tensions were reaching a boiling point in December 2021, Russia took the initiative of drafting two mutual security treaties, one between Russia and the United States and the other between Russia and NATO. These were not take it or leave it demands, but drafts for negotiation. Unfortunately, the United States and NATO summarily dismissed Russia's proposals. By building up Ukraine's military, promising Ukraine NATO membership, and dismissing negotiations, the US and its allies turned Ukraine into a dangerous weapon in their revived Cold War against Russia. Then, in the days leading up to February's Russia invasion, the OSCE ceasefire monitors documented thousands of explosions around the ceasefire line in Donbas, mostly on the Donetsk and Luhansk side, indicating a major escalation of artillery fire by Ukrainian government forces. So even in the immediate causes of the war, it is deceptive to describe the invasion as unprovoked, as Biden and US officials routinely do. By early 2022, Russia had amassed large military forces near Belarus' border and its own borders with Ukraine, all the while denying that it had plans to invade. It also formally recognized Donetsk and Luhansk People's Republics as independent countries. On February 24th, Russia invaded. The invasion was illegal on many counts. It was not an act of self-defense, and it certainly was not authorized by the United Nations. Under international law, including the Kellogg-Briand Pact and the UN Charter, the invasion was an illegal crime of aggression. Russia did not just move its invading forces into Donbas to support the breakaway republics, but it launched offensive towards the capital, Kyiv, and the second largest city, Kharkiv, in the northeast, and into the southern part of Ukraine from Crimea. Western analysts generally agree that Russia must have hoped to take quickly Kyiv and install a friendly government, but it encountered strong resistance from Ukrainian forces and was forced to withdraw from the north. Ukraine's Western neighbors responded to the invasion by granting asylum to millions of refugees, while the US and other NATO countries poured billions of dollars worth of weapons into Ukraine, stepped up their training of Ukrainian military, and provided it with intelligence to accurately attack important Russian targets. There has been little or no accountability for the weapons flooding into Ukraine. There are reports that as little as 30% of them may be reaching the front lines because they are either destroyed by Russian missiles or siphoned off into the black market, where they could end up in the hands of the Islamic State, neo-Nazis, or other dangerous groups around the world. This was precisely why the U.S. Congress prohibited the transfer of U.S. weapons to the Azov Regiment in 2018, as it became a magnet and a hub for international right-wing militant networks. Yet after the Russian invasion, all restraints were lifted, and thousands of tons of powerful and advanced weapons have poured in over the Polish border. There was so little debate about this in the US that when Congress passed an enormous $40 billion package for Ukraine, with most of the money to be spent on more and more lethal weapons for up to another decade, not a single Democrat voted against it. Not even Congresswoman Barbara Lee, who cast the lone, wise, and prophetic vote against the disastrous war in Afghanistan in 2001. In our book, we explain the peace negotiations in Turkey in March that could have already ended this war, and the largely unreported role of the US and British governments in killing those talks. The talks during the first month of the war produced the contours of a 15-point peace plan for a ceasefire, a Russia withdrawal, and a future for Ukraine as an independent, peaceful, and neutral country. On March 27th, President Zelensky told a national TV audience, "Our goal is obvious: peace and the restoration of normal life in our native state as soon as possible." Under the draft agreement, Ukraine would neither be a military ally of the United States and NATO, nor of Russia, with no foreign military bases or installations on its territory. Ukraine would get security guarantees from other countries. Russian speakers in Ukraine would be free to speak, read, and study in Russian. And the future of Crimea and Donbas would be determined by an internationally accepted political process during a transition period of several years. But none of that came to pass. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson went to Kyiv on April 9th and told Prime Minister Zelensky that the UK would not be party to any agreement between Ukraine and Russia, and that the collective West, as he called it, saw a chance to press Russia and was determined to make the most of it. Turkish diplomats who had been mediating the ceasefire talks reported that US Defense Secretary Austin delivered a similar message to Zelensky, and that these messages effectively killed their peace efforts. So early hopes for a negotiated peace were dashed, largely as a result of US and British determination to weaken Russia, even at the cost of rivers of Ukrainian blood, in an open-ended war that could last for years. The undermining of ceasefire talks was a tragic lost opportunity. Since the talks were abandoned, the slaughter and destruction has continued, with hundreds of Ukrainians killed every day. Russia has taken control of more territory, and despite the successful Ukrainian counteroffensive, Russia now occupies 20% of Ukraine. The sanctions against Russia have backfired, leading to soaring energy prices worldwide, while reduced grain exports have led to widespread hunger, particularly in the global south. Europe is facing an energy and home heating crisis. Meanwhile, no sign has honestly or publicly explained what its goals are in this war, or why they can possibly justify the total destruction of Ukraine and even the greater danger of nuclear war. Even the old war hawk Henry Kissinger is warning that US policy has blundered to the brink of a world war with no clear purpose or endgame in sight. He told the Wall Street Journal, "We are at the edge of war with Russia and China on issues which we partly created, without any concept of how this is going to end or what it's supposed to lead to. And here at home, we are told we don't have the funds for a decent healthcare system or free college education or housing for the unhoused. We cannot allow our public funds to be squandered on yet another unwinnable war and an even more all-consuming military budget. Governments in the global South are watching the impacts of this war plunge millions of their people into hunger and famine, while Europe's energy crisis is already sinking the continent into a recession. We in the US have been relatively unscathed by this war compared to many people elsewhere, but we are already facing rising prices, which will get worse as the war continues, and the US will not be exempt from the impacts of this looming global recession. With climate chaos jeopardizing the very future of life on this planet, this war is derailing our efforts to confront the climate crisis. Instead of a Green New Deal, we are now watching a mad scramble to produce more oil, gas, and coal as energy companies reap record profits from their disaster capitalism. And while the climate heats up and governments and corporations shift their already inadequate climate plans into reverse, Russia and the US are threatening us with yet another existential disaster. A nuclear apocalypse. We understand that some people may disagree with our analysis of this conflict, but hopefully we can all agree that we must do whatever we can to bring this war to an end. And that's why Code Pink is part of a coalition called Peace in Ukraine. We pressure our members of Congress and the White House to call for negotiations. We call on the media to promote the voice of peacemakers. We distribute our messages via social media, and we educate the public, including getting our book into libraries and classrooms. And we encourage you to join us. We must act now to say, stop the bloodshed, stop the bombing, stop the madness. We must work together to demand a ceasefire and negotiations, not more war. Thank you.
Okay. So we're back together and you hear me okay?
Yes. Yes, we can hear you, Medea.
Wonderful.
And Medea, I've known you 30 years. I went to Cuba with you.
Who is speaking?
Robin Larson.
Ah, hello, Robin.
We have some questions for you, of course, being... Oh, I'm sorry, I'm interrupting your own presentation.
Not at all. So I was going to just give some other things that maybe didn't come up so much in the video.
Okay, go for it.
Yeah. Well, you all probably heard about the missile that landed in Poland and killed two people. And immediately some of the news started reporting that it had to be from Russia. Luckily, the Polish head of state said, no, this did not come from Russia, although Zelensky from Ukraine said, we don't believe it, it didn't come from us. Anyway, when the news came out that a missile had struck and killed two people in Poland, it really sent shockwaves because the media started asking the State Department, are you going to invoke Article 4, which means that all of the countries in NATO would come together in an emergency session? And then they started asking, if indeed this came from Russia, will you invoke Article 5, which is the article in NATO that says that an attack on one is an attack on all? For the 24 hours after the unfortunate incident in which two people from Poland were killed, it really did seem like this was going to be one of the moments that we dreaded when the war was going to expand beyond Ukraine. And we were able to contain it for this time, because indeed it looked like it wasn't coming from Russia. But I think it should give people a sense of dread that such an incident is indeed going to happen again, and it might well be from a Russian missile the next time. It's very hard to, quote, contain this war. And it does mean that it could spill over to be a direct war with Russia by the NATO countries, including the US. And it could really mean a push towards the use of a nuclear weapon on the part of the Russians as a way to respond to a war with 40 countries from NATO. I was watching the news programs this morning on CNN with Fareed Zakaria. I don't know if any of you watch those programs, but it was painful to see the guest that he had on talking so tough and saying, this is not a time to push for negotiations. This is a time to really stick it to Russia. And if they need an off ramp, let Russia come begging for it. I find that kind of talk so disturbing because of what it means is keep the war going and let Ukrainians keep dying and suffering in this war. We've seen how Russia has retaliated after every advance that Ukraine has had on the battlefield, most recently in recovering Kherson, and Russia retaliated by targeting a lot of the infrastructure, leaving many people in Ukraine in the dark with the onset of winter. Those in the US who are sitting comfortably in their homes saying, let this war keep going, have no idea what it really means on the ground. I think it's interesting that the civilians in the US government seem to be taking that maximalist position of let's fight to the last for Ukrainian, while the people inside the Pentagon have become the more cautious ones. The chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Mark Milley, is the highest advisor to President Biden from the military. And it was quite astounding to hear him last week come out and say, the Ukrainians have done a heroic job on the battlefield. They have seized about as much as they're going to be able to do. It's now a stalemate, and they should seize the moment and go to the negotiating table. Of course, the response to that was one in which the administration felt obligated to push back. But this is the reality coming from people who know what it's like on the battlefield, who understand that every advance that our media plays up is followed by retaliation from the Russian side. When it comes to Ukraine, there is certainly a lot of nationalistic fervor to try to win this war on the battlefield. And while Zelensky at one point was talking about the compromises that would need to be made, now they're talking about getting back every inch of territory, including Crimea, which people inside the Pentagon realize is not a rational position to have. When it comes to what's happening inside Russia, I think there is more and more opposition to this war as people get beyond the state-censored media, as mothers and fathers are looking for their loved ones who have been killed in this war, as more and more young men decide to flee the country in order not to have to fight, as there are more organizations being set up to help those conscientious objectors, we still have to recognize that Putin remains in control and has staked his reputation on this war, which means he's not about to put his tail between his legs and go home. Indeed, there has to be an off ramp, especially since this war is affecting the entire region and the entire world. When it comes to Europe, there have been some divisions that are going to grow as the effects of the war continue to hurt the people of Europe. The sanctions against Russia have really had a blowback effect, because Europe was so dependent on relatively cheap energy coming from Russia, especially Germany, which is the strongest country economically in Europe, and its manufacturing sector has really been hurt by the tripling of gas prices, of energy prices in general. And this will hurt the pocketbooks of the Europeans as winter sets in. And there will be more people on the streets in protest saying, we want to see an end to this war. This war is fueling the inflation that is hurting us in the grocery store, at the gas pump, and paying our energy bills. And a similar thing is going to happen here in the United States. In the where it stands now, though, the Democrats have taken ownership of this war. You have the $40 billion that was passed without one opposing vote in the Democratic Party. You have another $37 billion that the White House has asked for that should be voted on any day now, and we will probably not see one Democrat oppose that tranche of money to Ukraine. And in the meantime, when there were 30 Democrats from the Progressive Caucus that did stand up and put their name on a very, very mild letter to President Biden, thanking him for all he has done for Ukraine, saying that the Democrats were working with him on giving military and economic aid to Ukraine, but it's time to pair that with negotiations. All hell broke loose, and I would say in large part thanks to Nancy Pelosi, who pushed back so hard on the people who signed that, saying, you know, how could you do that at close to election time when we have to show a unified front in support of President Biden and this war? The pushback was so great that what happened is something I've never seen before. Within 24 hours, a letter that was signed, sealed, and delivered to President Biden was then rescinded. So right now, you have very few people, Ro Khanna being one of the only Congress people who have maintained a position saying, yes, we need negotiations, but he is pretty much a lone voice out there now. Not so on the Republican side. You have 57 Republicans in the House, 11 in the Senate who voted against the $40 billion. You have Republicans coming in now, like the next Speaker of the House, Kevin McCarthy, who says, we don't want a blank check for Ukraine. He has been pushed back by people in his own party who said, we must continue the military support. So he's softened his position and is now saying, well, we need accountability. But in any case, where we see opposition is coming from right-wing extremists in the Republican House and Senate, but also from people like Donald Trump, who has used the opposition to this war very skillfully in his rallies, in social media, and in his acceptance speech when he said, you get Biden and you get war. He has said, if I were in power, this war would not have happened because I would have talked to Putin, whereas Biden refuses to talk. And I think that's something that a skillful politician like Trump understands resonates with a base that's increasingly questioning whether spending all this money on keeping a war going in Ukraine is in the interests of the American people. And so it is quite topsy-turvy that you see the Democratic Party, including those who will call themselves progressives, people like Barbara Lee, who are standing behind this war, where the, quote, peacemakers tend to be the extreme right in the Republican Party, and then people like Tucker Carlson on Fox News. This puts us in a real bind when you have folks like Bernie Sanders, and I talk directly to people in his office, saying that you cannot negotiate with Putin, and has been opposed to such a rational thing as saying we need a ceasefire and negotiations. And so I just want to also say that when people say you can't talk to Putin, there is a very short answer to that, which is, let's see you try and then tell us if it didn't get anywhere. I would like to see Biden talk to Putin. I would like to see our Secretary of State talking to his counterpart, Sergei Lavrov, in Russia, and seeing if they could come up with any ways of moving the negotiations forward between Ukraine and Russia and between the US and Russia. And speaking of Ukraine and Russia, there have been talks on very specific issues. For example, when the Zaporizhia nuclear plant, the largest nuclear plant in Europe, was being shelled, the sides came together, thanks to the UN and Turkey's mediation, and brought in experts from the International Atomic Energy Association. When the grain was not getting out of Ukraine to people who desperately needed it around the world, there were negotiations and a land and sea corridor created so that 10 million tons of grain has been able to get out of the country. There have been prisoner swaps, many of them. So there have been talks, and I think it gives an indication that these could be spread to more in-depth talks about what kind of concessions both parties would have to make to end this war. And between the US and Russia, it's interesting that I already mentioned that but President Biden is not talking, and either is the Secretary of State. But recently we've learned that the Secretary of Defense, the head of the National Security Council, and the head of the CIA have all been talking to Russia in very recent times, because they are terrified about this turning into a direct confrontation with Russia and potentially a nuclear war. So their talks have been limited, supposedly, to how do we stop this confrontation from spreading. But I don't know about you, I feel like there have to be talks about how do we stop the confrontation itself, because it is the Ukrainians that are dying, that are suffering every day that this war goes on. So I think this brings me to the end of this part of the presentation, which is to say that I don't think that we're doing enough as people who want to see peace to put the pressure on our elected officials and on the White House. And that's why I've been going on a 50-city book tour. That's why I've been doing presentations like this one, to try to see what more we can do to get our elected officials to understand that the next $37 billion in funding, most of it for weapons, is not a good idea. That calling for negotiations is not appeasement of Putin, but is the only rational way to move forward. We have a coalition called peaceinukraine.org. You can see online, you can join it as individuals or as organizations. We have a faith-based letter that we just initiated 3 days ago with the Fellowship of Reconciliation, asking for faith leaders to sign on, calling for a Christmas truce like happened in World War I. We are working to get environmentalists to see how disastrous this war is for the environment in so many different ways, as was evidenced in COP27, which included people saying that the call for the wealthier countries to give $100 billion a year for climate mitigation has never been met by the wealthy countries. And yet in less than a year, we've put over $100 billion into this war in Ukraine. That's money that's needed to address the climate crisis. So let me stop here by thanking you for giving me a chance to address you, and now we can move on to discussion.
Thank you so much, Medea. You're so comprehensive. There is a very comprehensive question, which is reiterated and summarized in some shorter questions. I've got a little handful here. But I'll start with this particular one. Defending Rights and Dissent, which I think is the title of the title of something, I'm not quite sure what, is asking the public to tell Congress to reassert its constitutional power to wage war and not allow the president or the Pentagon to wage war in secret and not allow either of them to commit acts of war by the U.S. without congressional approval? And I think the gist of that question is, what would you suggest we do if we should be pursuing that course, or whether we should be pursuing another course?
Absolutely. Defending Rights in Dissent is a very wonderful organization that I work closely with, and I think they're totally right. It is ridiculous that the United States that the U.S. government pretends it's not directly involved in this war, when it's not only U.S. taxpayers' money that is funding this war, it's also that they have been training Ukrainians since 2015. They have U.S. has now in this war not only intelligence capabilities that are helping the Ukrainians in their targeting, but also have special forces that are inside Ukraine. And when I talked about the example of the missiles falling into Poland, that's just one example. What if an American gets killed inside Ukraine? So yes, I agree that we should go back to Congress having to declare wars before it gets involved in arming, training, and in so many different ways, working with one side against another, but not calling it a war.
And I'll now continue that. I'll continue with some of the other questions. Do you see an anti-war movement developing with all of what you've already done and currently in right now in this particular time? Do you think, and what do you think religious communities should and can and should do to play in that anti-war movement?
I see it developing. Unfortunately, it's slowly, because it's so hard to break through the fog of war, the sensationalism in the media, hard for people to understand this is not an issue about how we feel about Russia. And I don't know about how the rest of the audience feels, but I feel that they have done a horrific thing by invading Ukraine. This is about how we going to move the actors that we have access to. And whenever there's a chance to sign a letter supporting Russian war resistors or even raising money for them, we do that. Whatever we can do to support any side that is pushing for peace is something we must do. But in this case, I think we must push our own government. And that's where I think faith-based groups can have a major role to play. I mentioned the letter that we just put out, and you can find it on the peaceinukraine.org website, or I'll add it in the chat. We can also use the power of the faith-based groups to make meetings with our elected officials, both in the House and the Senate, and talk about why, from a moral perspective, we feel that there are no good wars, and this is not a good war. And then in terms of building up a broader movement, I see it happening in places throughout the country, that more and more people are breaking through that fog of war. I'm amazed at the book sales. We've already sold thousands and thousands of copies of our book, which really only came out very recently. If people thought that the video was useful, it's online, open to the public. You can show it we're encouraging people to have house parties, to show it in classrooms and in faith-based settings. So yes, there is an anti-war movement that is building. There was a great webinar that happened yesterday, put on by a group called the People's Forum in New York City, that had thousands of people watching it. People like Noam Chomsky have been incredibly wonderful at speaking out in such a clear way, and he gets huge audiences. People like Chris Hedges, I was on his show, and he told me that there's been about 250,000 views of that. So the word is getting out, and people are starting to organize.
A typical white power tactic is framing people for crimes they did not commit. Do Ukraine slash US UK, do their false flag operations qualify as white power frame-ups?
Well, I don't quite understand that question.
I'm not sure I do either.
but I'll answer it in a more generic way, which is I think that we have to recognize that when there is war, there are war crimes, and that some of them might be sensationalized, exaggerated, or even made up. But we shouldn't underestimate what happens when soldiers are out in the battle and the hate has built up and there are atrocities committed. I know that there are a lot of atrocities that have been committed by the Russians, and there are also war crimes that have been committed by the Ukrainians. We saw a report that came out by Amnesty International, and the pushback was tremendous because people in the Western world didn't want to hear about Ukrainian war crimes. But unfortunately, in war, all sides commit atrocities.
Yeah, My Lie being one of our cases in point. Could you address Russia's claim of quote unquote Nazi presence and influence in Ukraine?
I think we try to explain that in the video and we go into it in much greater depth in the book. But to have a short answer, think that the fact that they have had very little success in the ballot box and in terms of representation does not mean that they are not important actors in the battleground. They are the ones that did not want Zelensky to do what he promised when he ran for office as a peace candidate and said he was going to go talk to the breakaway republic leaders in the Donbass. And when he tried to do that, these extreme right elements threatened to hang him from a tree. They are the ones who were paramilitary forces that were causing a lot of the death and destruction in the Donbass from 2014 on. And I think that because in the heat of battle, they tend to be very fierce fighters. They gain disproportionate power during this wartime. So I would not overemphasize their influence, but I also wouldn't dismiss it.
Now, here's another question. This is actually, this is from Meg Whitaker Green, who's one of our ministers. What is the off-ramp? What do you think the off-ramp could be? In talking with Putin, if President Biden and the Secretary of State are not talking, and if the CIA is, what does Putin get? Does he have to get something before he stops?
Absolutely, and hello to Meg. Yes, there. It's interesting that before the war happened, Russia had put forward a proposal that was totally dismissed. Then there were the talks that were happening in March and April that were getting somewhere until the Western countries came in and said, no, we'll support you on the battlefield instead. And now both sides have hardened. They have polar opposite positions. On the one hand, you have the maximalist position from Ukraine saying we want every inch of territory back, including Crimea. That would be very, very difficult. And you have the Russians who did that very sham referendums in four of the provinces saying these now belong to Russia, but they can't even hold the capital city of Kherson, for example. These, I would say, are bargaining positions. And the issue is how to put the pressure on all the parties to get to the table. And I must say there are some leaders like the Secretary General of the United Nations and the Pope who have been really fantastic on this in pushing, but we need more leaders to step up and do that as well. I think in the video we outlined some of the ways that this will end if it doesn't go into a wider war, and that is Ukraine has to be a neutral state with guarantees by strong outside parties that they would be protected if they were invaded again, that the Russians would have to keep Crimea, and that an issue of Crimea could be determined down the road in terms of any kind of internationally monitored referendum. A similar kind of thing in Donbass with an internationally monitored referendum. And then I think what Russia needs is also talks with the United States. It's quite astounding that now that the relations between the US and Russia are at the lowest that they've been since the Cold War, there's actually some, they are planning to initiate talks around the START agreement on nuclear weapons because they both know how dangerous this is. So there need to be talks, and you know, Russia is surrounded by US bases, by five nuclear powered US nuclear weapons in Europe, by bases that are very close to Russia in Poland and Romania. All of this has to be negotiated because Russia does have legitimate security issues as well that must be addressed.
Is there anybody else who wants to pose questions right now who hasn't written them down, but is they're burning in their minds? Please.
Thank you. My name is Dolores. Many Americans discount support for Russia at all because Putin is an autocrat, has been in power for 22 years without any election, and jails any opposition to him. Whereas, for example, in the US, at least we can discuss, and we do have freedom of speech, and can speak out against American policies like we're doing right now. And this would not happen in Russia or a Russian-supported country.
Well, I would say that while we do have more of an open democratic system in this country, it is unfortunately one that is that where the Democrats and Republicans seem to agree all the time is on issues of war. The U.S. has waged illegal, horrific wars in just talking about recently in Afghanistan, in Iraq. And in the shock and awe that the U.S. Inflicted on Iraq in the first month, they did more damage than the Russians have done so far. And the U.S. has never been held accountable for its war crimes. That is a problem. The Russian invasion and the Russian system is one that is highly authoritarian and censored. Yet, on the other hand, we have to talk to Russia because you don't talk to your friends at the negotiating table, you talk to your enemies. And for anybody who is concerned about the threat of nuclear war, I think it is in our interests to not only help the Ukrainians by stopping this war, but get more of the agreements that the US and Russia have had in the past about nuclear weapons that the US has taken itself out of under the Trump administration. And every time we get out of a treaty or a deal with Russia, we make the world a more dangerous place. You might not like the Chinese system. They have a very different system than we do. But I don't know about you. I was very pleased to see President Biden talking to President Xi in China. Their system is a very controlled one as well, but it has brought hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. So we have to look around the world and say that none of our systems is the greatest, but we have what we have, and we better find ways of living together peacefully in this world.
Here's one more question.
Yeah, this isn't exactly a question. I have a sense that this is very important. I've been very involved in the Ukrainian war with Russia and the conflict. In fact, for years and years, it's like Russia has acted as our sort of bête noire and we keep punching at it. And I agree with all that. But I also don't agree with setting up a conflict theory. I don't agree with setting up a conflict theory where the United States comes out like a monster. And I'm sorry about that. That's my political point of view. I want to read a poem that I wrote to show the fact that Americans really care about this situation, okay? This is like a new situation. It's a very short poem, okay? It's called The War, and we can also think of ourselves because obviously I'm projecting stuff on you know, Russia too. It's called The War in Ukraine, spelled Y-O-U. I don't know how it started. I don't know where it began, except in someone's storied brain, someone, the leader of his land. How dare he think he could take his neighbor's state? How cruelly he designed his plan. Torpedoes flying wildly, never mind the lives. Homes, apartments, blocks, schools, hospitals, theaters, playgrounds, now pulverized with human flesh. Bodies found and digitalized send terror around the world. Urban streets running blood. Iconic silhouettes, canvas pavements, fire, smoke, and brimstone, hell. Histories are marked, sorrow abounds. So.
Thank you for that very beautiful poem.
Beautiful, beautiful, really beautiful. Have we got other questions? Other questions? Questions or comments? Yes. No, Dolores.
Yeah, this is Dolores again. We just returned from a trip to countries over in Hungary that the Russians, where the Russians were for quite a while. And I don't mean, I mean, after the Second World War. And after the invasion of Hungary. And I spoke to many of the people there. We were in Hungary and the Czech Republic. And and every one of them spoke about the time when Russia was influenced in their, was a big influence in their country. And they were just so happy when they left. And, you know, so I feel sometimes that if people want to join, people sometimes want to join NATO and be in a more democratic society or socialist democratic society rather than under the Russian regime. And I just spoke to many people there and that's just the way they felt about it. And that's just a personal observation. So some, I think some countries don't want to be under the Russian influence and no matter what happens. Thank you.
Yes, sure. I understand that. But you do have to recognize that Russia does have its security concerns as well. And it's like an analogy of saying that Mexico wants to have a military alliance with China. The U.S. has had 200 years of the Monroe Doctrine of saying nobody else can interfere in our backyard, which was all of Latin America. So Russia has a similar kind of sense that the U.S. has betrayed it after 1991 and the reunification of Germany by incorporating more and more countries into a US-led military alliance. And those who think that NATO is a defensive alliance, I encourage you to get a copy of our book and read the chapter because it's very important that you know people in the US really don't know what NATO is. In Europe, they're much more attuned to NATO. And they're, people like us, part of the Unitarians, are the ones who have been opposing NATO in Europe because
NATO has been pushing them to spend more and more. In fact, the goal is 2% of their gross domestic product on the military. In the meantime, our friends in the European countries have said, we don't want to be like in the United States, spending so much money on your military. We have a national healthcare system and you don't. We have free college education and you don't. And that's because we don't spend all that money on the military. And NATO is trying to force us to do that. So those are just some counter kind of arguments about why these military alliances are not helpful if we want to live in a world in peace. And I do want to put in the chat, I'm putting in the link to the call for the Christmas truce. Meg, we would love to see you sign on to that and any other of the faith-based leaders that you all are in touch with.
So any other comments, questions? I guess not. I guess we are just about to the end of our time, Medea. It's so wonderful to see you. Oh, good.
Great. Unfortunately, what I have to say is that the United States of America, in my humble opinion, is anything but a democratic social republic. Anything but that.
Well, I think the, millions of people would agree with you, especially young people. As I travel around the country, it's very heartbreaking to hear young people say they have no interest in participating in this electoral system. They see it as not representing them in either of the parties. And I do see a lot of those young people taking their activities to other areas that they think are more useful, like grassroots organizing around environment, getting involved with us around challenging the military by divesting from the weapons industries in their college campuses, in their cities, those kinds of things. So people have very different views on how they view our system, but let's recognize that the U.S. has been at war since the founding of our nation, whether it's the genocide against indigenous people, slavery, or all of the wars that we've been involved in and the overthrow of people's countries around the world. And while today we're focusing on the horrors that Russia is perpetrating on the people of Ukraine, we continue to sell weapons to Saudi Arabia for its war in Yemen. We continue to give weapons to Egypt that has 60,000 political prisoners. And we continue to give weapons to Israel that uses them every day to repress the people in Palestine. So whether or not you think our system is democratic, it's certainly one that needs to get better and better, both domestically as well as in our foreign policy.
Well, Medea, thank you so much for your presentation, for being here, for the work that you're doing, for the writing, the book you wrote, the extraordinary effort you're putting into getting the word out about this and provoking and promoting these kinds of discussions. This is very important for us here, I think, to have these kind of ideas presented. There's not universal agreement on everything, which is fine, but it gives us an opportunity to discuss this, and it needs to be discussed. There's been too much silence about this issue for too long, and it's too important to keep silent about it. So again, appreciate the fact that you've been here and what you're doing, and that you're giving us an opportunity to look at this stuff in a different way, from a different point of view. I just wanted to say that the video of this presentation, as I said earlier, will be up on YouTube. I encourage everyone here to take a look at that, to get the link, send it to your friends and whoever, relatives. Those of people, you know, around the country that you know, people you're in contact with, so that we can actually promote this discussion. And I think also a much needed anti-war movement. And I would also encourage the UU here to take a more forthright stand publicly in opposition to this war and in the spirit of which it's been presented today. So that said, I just wanted to make a few announcements. And one thing I just wanted to ask everyone here is this kind of discussion around the war, if people here have an interest in continuing this dialogue in perhaps in another forum, if you do have an idea about that and how we might do that and how we might push this issue forward in a more, you know, along the way that it really needs to be done towards a more robust movement, you can contact me. You can send an email to the forum at uusf.org. You can talk to me. You can talk to Dolores or Robin, David or Melvin, those of us who are the committee for forum, and with your suggestions and so on. The other thing is that we're gonna have another forum on December 11. That's the next one coming up, with a member or a soon to be member of this church, Wayne Cheung, who took a very brave action in defense of animal rights at Smithfield in Utah, faced a long sentence in prison for doing that, but they won their case, which was very interesting and also reflects the potential among the people here. When we get dismayed about the public here taking action, this was a very deeply conservative part of the country, and they, the jury found them not guilty in that town, which is very dependent on Smithfield for their livelihood. So that was a very good story, and he's going to be talking about that. And then we're also planning a forum on Iran, on the uprising, but also the horrendous situation with the political prisoners in Iran. And that's going to be for January the 8th. And perhaps there'll be other things before that. But I don't know if you want to announce, Medea, your event in Berkeley at KPFA at the Hillside Club. Did you want to?
I just put it in the chat, December 1st, 7 p.m. You can see it on the Code Pink website if you go to Code Pink Ukraine book tour.
Okay, we do have a copy. I tried to get more copies of your book, but I wasn't successful in getting them. But we have a copy of the book if somebody wants to buy it back there on the table. And I've read the book, and I would encourage everyone here to read it. It's very helpful to have that kind of background information when you get in discussions with people. It gives you more confidence that you've got the information. So with that, unless somebody else has something to say, I think we'll end it here. And I want to thank you, Medea, so much for what you're doing. And we'll be paying more attention.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure being with you. Good questions, good discussion, and onwards towards peace.
Yes, indeed. Okay.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty.